I'm Jim Moyer, but I'm better known as my alter ego, Vic Reeves. Ladies! I'm going to explore the life and career of Britain's last 500cc world motorcycle racing champion.
The crowd rises, the crowd roars, and Barry Sheen leads.
My all-time favourite racing legend.
Sheen gives it everything he's got.
So, I'm going to meet his family and friends.
There you are.
Hey, mate. How are you?
I'll ride motorbikes more powerful and more valuable than I deserve.
I really don't want to wreck it.
To get under the skin of the man who tore off the racetrack and onto the front pages.
That's me, all right. Yeah, all right.
The man who survived horrific injuries and came back stronger.
There's no stopping Sheen as he triumphantly crosses the line.
The man who did it all with a cheeky smile the world fell in love with. My hero, Barry Sheen. Motorcycling, it's in my blood.
My dad used to race Norton's in the 50s, and then when I was born, he was under orders to stop doing that. But we never stopped going to see road racing, and my favourite was Oliver's Mount, because it was such a dangerous track.
One memory stands out from my days watching Man and Machine on that twisting hillside track in Scarborough. It was here that I first caught sight of the late, great Barry Sheen. For a teenage boy in the 1970s, it was fantastic. Barry was like a 200-mile-per-hour pop star.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Barry Sheen.
He wore the aftershave I wanted to wear. He was on the cover of my sister's magazines.
Yes, Barry Sheen!
He was on the chat shows that my mum and dad watched.
He's what does, in fact, ultimately separate, you know, the world champion from the rest.
It's just something that you either got or you haven't. But I'm glad I've got it.
I think one of the reasons why Barry did so incredibly well on track was pure determination. Ruthlessly dogged in the way that he thought about a race, and that gave him speed, that gave him time on the track.
She leads! Marvellous bit of overtaking.
To add to that, he had the perfect model girlfriend. And more importantly for me and thousands of fellow petrolheads, he won the motorcycling world championships twice.
Victory after victory.
No other Brit has done it since. Now, I've been given the chance to ride his actual world championship-winning bike. The Texaco Heron Suzuki RG500. 0-60 in 3 seconds. Up to 100 in under 6. And a top speed of 187. Amazing. But it's just that I quite like slow. And if I'm going to be riding Baz's bike, I'll have to deal with riding fast.
Sheen is going like a rocket.
From 100 miles an hour to 180 miles an hour, you don't really notice the difference.
I have to be positive and say, yes, I'm up for doing it, but, I mean, anyone would be worried. So, but, you know, at the same time, fabulously excited. I mean, do they really know what they're doing, letting me loose on this thing? And am I capable of riding it?
In In the late 1960s, long before riding the famous 500s, Barry cut his teeth on the much lower-powered Spanish Bull Taco. Singing
a song in the morning. Barry's career started in a very unusual way. His father, Frank Sheen, that we all call Franco, he did a lot of tuning for Bull Taco, the Spanish two-stroke machines. And Frank used to use young Barry as a sort of test rider.
He started racing, and he did start at Brands Hatch. I think he crashed the first race, but got back on, showed, even with a few bruises and bangs, that he could carry on.
When you raced, though, did you understand that you were something special, that you were quicker than the other guys?
I was very keen to do well, but it was something that I enjoyed so much. But I never ever... I didn't realise I was any good until all of a sudden I thought, I won about 10 races.
The Bull Taco was the bike that set Barry on the road to fame and fortune. And I'm going to get to see it up close. Steve Parrish was Barry's World Championship teammate and part of his inner circle of close friends who lived the high life, known as the Squadron.
The Squadron, what's that?
The Squadron. Barry was kind of squadron leader. I was a wing commander.
So he started it off?
He started it off, yeah. But I was the only one that had a plane. They all had helicopters. They had more money than I did.
Steve brought me to RAF Wittering, former home of the Harrier, to jump back in time and ride a piece of racing history.
That was very cool. There it is.
There it is, an absolute corker. That is the original Barry Sheen bike. 250cc. Water-cooled, which in all fairness is actually way ahead of its time back then. But you'll notice it has no kickstart on it. It has no self-start on it. This, to me, is how a motorbike should look. Try it for and size.
It's a pretty little bike.
It is a very pretty little bike, yeah. It'll
be quite... To begin my tuition, Steve had to show me how to start the bike.
So, to jump start, or bump start, we would call it, you have to run alongside it, whichever side you're comfortable with.
I'm not comfortable at all.
Right, OK. Well, you've got to put it in first gear, run along, as we did on the start line. I mean,
you were good at it.
I wasn't bad. My legs were OK, better than they are now. But poor old Barry, with his skinny little legs, he wasn't real good at starting.
And they're off, but Barry Sheen, who's notorious for his poor starts, done it again.
Barry does wheelies, but once again, he makes a bad start.
So he'd be on the front row of the grid and sometimes get away about 10th.
How tall was he?
About the same as me. Tiny bit shorter than I was.
So he'd be like...
So the perfect size, of course.
Light and breezy.
Yeah, we both weighed 10 stone.
But I used to be 10 stone in those days, but now with my incredible mass, this machine's going to slow down to about 15 mile an hour.
Want to have a
go? Come on, then.
All right, then. You have to put it in gear, and then you run along the side of it, and then
I've seen it
bump start because you sit on there and that stops the back wheel from locking up and then away you go.
What stops the bike from going over?
You do.
That Bull Taco as a thing, aesthetically, it's one of the most beautiful things I've seen. It's a very, very pretty bike. It's got charm and beauty. But the thing I'm worried about is this bump start, because heard that that bike is worth quite a bit of money, so I really don't want to wreck it. All right, so... Right,
that's the position you're going to end up in with the engine running.
Time to try and master what my hero Barry Sheen struggled with for 20 years.
That's it. You've got it.
Bump starts.
Then off, clutch in.
Yeah.
You don't need much throttle. Just as soon as it fires, pull that clutch in. Now, do you want me to run beside you?
Yeah, you're going to have to do some work now.
All right, OK.
Here we go.
Come on, then. Come on, fast as you can. Run, run, run. Ready, when you're ready, jump. Oh! Shall I help you? Oh, she was no near. Right, I'm going to push you. Here we go. No!
like a wild stallion, like a young wild stallion. It's not like a modern bike. You have to really like wrestle with it and control it and ride it. And it feels like it wants to get away all the time. And I don't know how Barry Sheen did it in a race with that amount of vibration. The vibration is so much, it goes right through the handlebars, through your hands, up your arms and into your mind. And it's so much so that you can't actually feel whether your hands are on the handlebars. A lot of adrenaline. There's adrenaline actually seeping out of the bottom of my trousers now.
In 1968, Barry was 17 years old and getting podium finishes at professional race meets on his dad's Bultacos. But he wanted more, a lot more.
I like to win every race that I ride in, be a world champion, be known generally as the best motorcycle racer there's ever been, be the most popular motorcycle racer there's ever been, and do the most for the sport that anyone's ever done.
Now he set about his plan for world domination.
What Barry realised very quickly in his racing career was that you need to have top scale machinery. You can't, it doesn't matter how good you are if your bike isn't good enough. And the Bultacos were not really international standard Grand Prix bikes.
So Barry persuaded Dad Franco to part with £2,000, a huge investment, to buy him an X-Works 125 Suzuki. It worked, and early successes meant he progressed quickly to bigger, more powerful, and more prestigious bikes. And in 1974, the Suzuki GB Works team, as ambitious as he was, signed him as their number one rider.
Gene flies ahead.
He'd made it to the 500cc World Championships.
Second place makes it a bright day for Barry Sheen on his Grand Prix debut for Suzuki.
He finished sixth in his debut season. Good work for a rookie rider on an unproven bike. 1975 was predicted to be Barry's breakthrough year. And he was going to announce it at the pre-season race the whole world watched. The iconic American endurance event, the Daytona 200.
Big thing is Daytona. If you can win Daytona, your bike is better than anyone else's, your riders are better than anyone else.
Sheen was going shoulder to shoulder with titans of the sport, the best the world championship had ever produced, 15-time world champion Giacomo Agostini, and America's number one, Kenny Roberts.
There was nothing that was going to stop Barry from winning. The bike was right, he was right, he was so much on top of the world. He was already world champion in his head.
All Barry had to do was get on the track and prove it.
Everything was still and quiet, and I could feel my back was really, really sore. Couldn't feel my legs or anything. Then I could feel it was kind of all warm on my back. And I looked down, I could see blood on the floor. Oh, God, there's no way I'm going to get away with this.
Travelling at 175 miles per hour on his practice lap, Barry's rear tyre had split. The force threw him over 200 yards along the asphalt. It was the highest speed crash in the history of motorcycle racing.
I feel as if I've been barbecued. My arse and my back and my shoulders.
Did they ever get to that one on your back?
No way, I didn't tell them about it. It hurt enough when it was doing the other ones.
Yeah, but you ought to get them to look at that real quick, because it's in the kidney area, according to that back thing you were wearing. And it put a hole completely through it.
Yeah.
So don't put it off too long.
Daytona International Speedway.
The day after, I go to see him at the hospital, and I see him look happy, because he said to me, "Oh, ciao, Ago, how are you?" but still with his cigarette. So I say, okay, if he smokes, it's because he's okay.
How he dealt with that pain is really hard to imagine. He was very badly hurt. His leg was really badly broken. The courage is conspicuous.
The checkered flag flies. Gene Romero has just won the Daytona 200, the world's greatest motorcycle race. He'll be pulling into victory lane in about 1 minute.
I got a broken femur, I think you call it. I busted my wrists just here. Collarbone, a couple of vertebrae, taken a lot of skin off. All in the wrong places. Other than that, I feel brand new.
Incredibly, just 7 weeks after cheating death at Daytona and with an 18-inch pin in his left leg, Barry got back on his bike to race again. Almost overnight, he became a red, white and blue leather-clad superhero to every British school kid. And growing up in the 70s, that's what he was to me. Now I'm older, though not necessarily wiser, I realise there's got to be more to Bionic Barry Sheen than the myth. I want to find out more about the man behind the visor. So I've come to meet the woman who knew him from the beginning.
Hello, Maggie.
Hi.
Barry's sister, Maggie.
Come in.
Come on, let's find out what he was all about.
I like the smile in your fingertips. I like the way that you move your hips. I like
Is that Barry there?
Yes. That's my mum and my grandma and Barry.
Is that you?
Oh, and me.
Hello.
Wasn't I young?
Did you get on well?
Not too bad. When he was younger, he was horrible because he was... we used to fight like cat and dog. He started smoking at a very young age and he got caught smoking and told Mum and Dad that I'd given him the cigarettes and I hadn't.
How old was he?
11. Or maybe even younger than that.
Did he always like to get in front of the camera then?
Yeah. Yeah. Was always very self-confident.
There's Franco reading motorcycle news. So your dad was a big influence?
A very big influence, yeah.
So if your dad wasn't involved in motorcycles, and Barry may have been, he would have been a star at something else.
Well, yeah, I can't even think what he would have been because life was always with motorcycles.
But did he want to, he wanted to be the best? He wanted to be a star?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And he was very good, actually, Barry, very clever at getting people to do things for him.
Yeah.
But he didn't do it in a nasty way. He always remembered people's names and he was very good at that.
So he could charm them.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, Mr. Charm himself.
Yeah.
Very good.
He didn't just demand it. He had ways.
No, he had ways of...
persuasion.
Yes. Yeah, he was pretty good. I think he did that most of his life. Yes, I think you need to be a bit... self-centered and to achieve what he achieved, because he did become a world champion, and you don't do that just by being a bit complacent. You know, you've got to
know what you want and want everyone to help you get it.
That's exactly right.
He seemed like he was good fun. I think I might have got on with him, you know, a bit of a show off. But you would have to admit that he wants stuff and he's going to get what he wants. So I'm going to have to find out a bit more about that. ...1976 would prove to be the year that Barry really got what he wanted. He wanted to put Daytona behind him, build up his fitness and win the world championship that he'd been denied. And he wanted to stay in the headlines.
It's a shame, actually, that you have to go and half kill yourself before you get any publicity out of it. But I hope I don't have to crash again to stay in the news.
Barry didn't need to worry about that.
cops are out. They're running about.
Like millions of others, high-profile model Stephanie McLean had followed Barry's recuperation on TV and spotted a photo opportunity.
My agent said to me, we need some new photos of you. You know, have you got any ideas? So I said, well, actually, I do. I've seen these leathers on this motorcycle. It's called Barry Sheen. And I think a great shot would be in these leathers, you know, with a helmet, something strong, you know. I called him. He said, I know you. You're the old Spice Girl. Well, I said, well, I'm ringing up because I want to see if I can do a photo in some of your leathers. And he says, yeah, of course.
OK. Right.
He said, well, can I come over and have a look at them on you? So my husband was out, of course, otherwise it wouldn't have happened. On that first day, he said, you do know I'm going to try and get into your pants, don't you? He said it in such a way that you thought he was kind of joking, but he actually was deadly serious.
All of a sudden, this guy came up to us and he said, oh, I'm from the News of the World. And I said, oh, hi, I'm from Putney. And he said, well, look at this. And it was the, I think it was the Sun or the Daily Mirror, and it was a full-page thing out on there. And I couldn't believe it. That's my private life. My private life, well, it was my private life, put it that way.
Stephanie became an integral part of Barry's team, from It Girl to Pit Girl. She traded the camera lens for a stopwatch.
You're almost like a possession, you know, of his. You know, he decided, you know, that he was going to have you, and that was it. He didn't want me to work. You had to be together all the time. I mean, I went to every race that he ever did from the time we got together. Barry was really focused on becoming world champion. Luckily enough, the first year I was with him, it all happened, and then he thought that I was, you know, his lucky mascot in a way, because he started winning, and so he didn't want me not to be there.
Now the mental pressure is really on.
To win his first world title, Barry had to dethrone two motorcycling royals, old adversary Giacomo Agostini and Britain's eight-time world champ Phil Reed. Barry's team, Suzuki, laid on an intimidating show of force for the other teams.
They had about half a dozen mechanics and Japanese mechanics and big transporters. The whole presentation of Suzuki's was more professional and more impressive.
Sheen and Reed are only inches apart, constantly swapping places right to the climax of this classic duel. Within sight of the flag, there's nothing in it. And at the line, it's Sheen who just wins by a hair's breadth tenth of a second.
Suzuki had built this new Square 4 RG500, which was now, in 76, had now reached a state of maturity where it was reliable.
Now Agostini and Sheen begin to pull away from the rest of the big field to the excitement of the large crowd.
Everything came together for him then. His talent was right. He had the right riding style for the bike, and the bike was very much right. And there was no one else as fast as him on the Suzuki.
Sheen gives it everything he's got to clock up the fastest lap of the day and puts the pressure on Hartog. It's fingers crossed as Barry really screams the Suzuki to the limit. Now there's no stopping Sheen as he triumphantly crosses the line.
Sometimes the best rider in the world doesn't necessarily win the world title, but Barry, without a doubt, was the best rider in the world in 1976 and a very deserved world title.
This win, Barry's fourth, gives him a virtually unassailable lead in the 500cc World Championship.
And it was a lead that would not be overtaken. With three races to go, he was world champion.
So far of the four. Well done, Barry. Congratulations.
Oh, it means a hell of a lot. It's the
biggest prize, if you like, in motorcycle racing. It's something I've been trying for, and it's, well, for the past 3 or 4 years, and it's got to be the ultimate goal as far as motorcycle race is concerned.
Well, Barry, as ever, surrounded by people, girls, glamour, do you really enjoy the lifestyle?
Oh, yeah, it's nice. It's not as glamorous as everyone makes out there, unfortunately.
Now world champion, if Barry thought he was under scrutiny before, the spotlight just got brighter.
Well, Barry was a pop star. There are not many pop star sportsmen. They certainly weren't up till then.
His love of the fast life wasn't just reserved for the track. Sheen enjoyed a playboy lifestyle.
And he enjoys the adulation of a growing number of enthusiasts and is regarded in much the same way as pop stars.
I'm trying to think of a picture that's not of Barry doesn't have a girl or several girls around him, and I don't think there's many. He was always surrounded by women. Women wanted to be around him. They were the perfect dream couple, the perfect sporting couple. Definitely the first Posh and Becks. I mean, they really had it all. And when you think about Barry and Stephanie in the 70s, they just epitomised the whole decade.
Back in the 70s and early 80s, there was hardly a sportsman on the planet that was more saleable than Barry Sheen.
This stuff's really 100%, you know?
Nothing beats a great smell of brew.
Oh, just special on all over, Henry.
Sure. No, at photo shoots, he knew what to wear, he knew how to smile, he knew how to stand. Of course, this guy was a pro.
Well, away you learn, isn't it?
Oh, it's got its brighter side, you know?
Well, Barry Sheen made bike racing appointment to view television. It had a massive switch on, and it was because of him.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Barry Sheen.
He realised that the more domination he had on TV would make motorcycling more interesting, bringing more people in. So they benefited from that. But he certainly knew that that was going to bring him the spoils.
1977. Barry was world champion. He had the public behind him. He had the media behind him. A powerful position going into the new season.
He did get a friend with Suzuki GB, and obviously they fully supported him to give them the exposure and publicity and attract the following that Barry brought to them from the fans. I think that's what some of his teammates resented. That's how Barry wanted it, because he had the best bikes and was winning the championships. Well, after I stopped, of course. Yeah.
A lot of people have been asking me whether I go out into the World Championship this year with the same kind of grit and determination that I did last year. Well, I'd say that I go out with even more determination, because I know now they sit me on kind of a podium and that everybody wants to beat me.
With total focus on regaining the title and total power, Barry decided to replace the manager, teammates and mechanic that had worked with him to win the world title just 6 months earlier. In came master technician Martin Ogborn and new teammates Pat Hennen and Steve Parrish.
He was great at manipulating people, and he'd got all these people around him. And then the Japanese would come over, and honestly, if Barry had said, you know, you've got to go lay on a bed of nails over there, they'd have done it, because they love Barry Sheen. Everyone loved Barry Sheen. He was a smart bloke.
He had his perfect team, his perfect mechanic. Now he wanted the perfect machine. And what Barry wanted, Barry got. In this crate is a piece of motorcycling history. And unpacking it is the man Barry entrusted to perfect this 1977 World Championship winning machine.
Whoa, get a glimpse.
Martin Ogborn.
Shall I go on the back side?
Yeah.
Well, this has got wedged on.
Who's going to restore it for me to ride?
That's it. Thank you.
There she lies.
Yeah.
Wow, look at that. So this was last ridden in 1977 by Barry?
Yes.
Wow, there she is. It's the same as when you last sorted it out.
Exactly, yeah.
The second generation RG500 Suzuki. More horsepower and a greater aerodynamic than anything Barry had ridden before.
Does she still work?
Well, when we take it out of the box, put it in the workshop, we'll find out. That's the only way to do
that. That needs a bit of work.
Yeah, we'll bleed that. That's the first thing I noticed as well.
Let's get it pulled apart and have a look then.
Yeah, then we'll find out.
And with my technical team talk over, I retired to take up my position in the corner.
Well, it's a very striking bike with a big history, so I'm slightly daunted about riding this bike.
This was a bike born out of obsession. Suzuki and Martin's obsession for engineering perfection and Barry's obsession with winning.
So all his input is this what you see before you now. What he'd been able to do was perfect the chassis to the way he rode and he wanted it. The engine he tended to leave to us. That, when I say left us, we did the work. He gave the ideas, but we did the work.
And so was he a good mechanic?
He said he was. We used to disagree with that.
Right.
Yeah, because we used to say if a rider picks up a spanner, leave. Because yeah. The answer is they're good at riding the bikes, we're good at putting them together.
Yeah. How demanding was he?
Incredibly demanding and incredibly selfish. He had to have exactly what he requested. So our job was to deliver it, even if it was impossible, even if it meant working all night. And he just demanded, I want this, I want this, I want that.
Did you like him?
Sometimes hated him, but liked him, yeah.
I suppose that's the way it has to work.
It has to. He was absolutely ruthless. Sometimes I've said to him, you're as dangerous off the track as what you are on it. And he would just go, that's what I'm supposed to be.
So he always got what he wanted?
Yes. Why wouldn't he? He was world champion.
This is where Sheen's skill really starts the show. And what we knew had to happen did happen. Barry overtook the Venezuelan to the delight of all his fans. Barry builds up a lead of 3 seconds and comes home the winner, to the great delight of Stephanie and his father. 1977, he won more 500cc Grand Prix than anyone else.
And sure enough, Barry was crowned world champion for a second time.
...1976, Barry Sheen, world champion. 1977, Barry Sheen, world champion. 1978, Barry met his match.
There was a new contender in town. Kenny Roberts. The dirt bike king of the USA. The stateside superhero who had his sights set on Barry's world championship crown.
He'd been brought up in a very tough school, and American dirt track racing was tough. And Kenny knew how to look after himself on and off the track.
Kenny's reputation had reached the championship. They knew he was fast. But Barry had more than speed on his side.
There are riders that can gain an advantage before even starting a race. Barry was a rider who could get into your head. At the starting grid, he would get the winner sensation and get into people's minds.
I remember Barry explaining to me at the first race in Venezuela, telling me, oh, the racetracks are dirty, you can't run slicks, you have to run this, and I was like going,
Barry could dominate people by just putting his bike on the grid. You'd look behind and go, God, if Sheen's here, I'm gonna lose. Suddenly Kenny had put his bike at the side of Barry's. And Kenny was looking down at Barry, you're going to go, I have to go as fast as what I'm going, kid, because I'm after you.
But Barry's mind games had no effect on Kenny.
To a man like Kenny Roberts, winning is everything.
Sheen was up against someone who was as committed to winning as he was.
And one of the things Kenny did was to enter two classes. He entered 250 and 500, riding the 250 only to learn the circuits, which showed a special level of dedication.
A mechanical breakdown in that first race in Venezuela handed victory to Sheen. But then Roberts' exceptional preparation started to pay off.
From the first excited flurry, there's a new significant leader, Kenny Roberts of America, on a Yamaha.
Initially, Barry looked at every single thing. He started screaming at the Suzuki mechanics to make his bike faster. He started screaming at everyone, probably even Stephanie. You must have got the times wrong, you can't be going that fast. Unfortunately, he was going that fast.
If it wasn't the bike or Steph's timekeeping, for Barry, there had to be a reason why he wasn't winning. It couldn't be that Kenny was simply better than him.
That's when he came up with the flu. He had a bug. And that's when the little Italian said, yeah, the bug is yellow and black and rides a Yamaha. If Barry Sheen wasn't racing there and wasn't who he was, I wouldn't have been as sharp as I was. There would have been no need. I got up every day to beat Barry Sheen. He was a world champion.
As the season continued, Barry fought back to within 3 points of Roberts. The British Grand Prix at Silverstone would prove decisive.
Race day, and more than 100,000 fans are here to see the duel between their home favourite Barry Sheen and challenger Kenny Roberts.
Need to beat Roberts here, that's for sure.
How do you feel about that?
Oh, OK, you know, I feel confident.
I've got to beat him. It doesn't really matter if it's 3 points or 20. I'm still going to try to win the race.
As Sheen pulled up to the starting grid, he knew if he failed to win, his dream of a hat-trick of championship titles was over. The race had barely begun when a torrential rainstorm threw everything into confusion.
There are skid hazards in the pace lane. The whole field senses the danger. Some riders keep their slicks and carry on. Others, like Barry Sheen, have already pulled into the pits for a change to wet weather tyres. Time and laps are lost when the riders rejoin the race.
In the pit stop chaos, race officials lost track of the riders' race positions.
The pit stoppers lap the laggards and are counter-lapped by others. Nobody seems to know who is what or where. But at the finish, Kenny Roberts of America is judged the winner.
It was Roberts who eventually took the checkered flag, and with it went Barry's title hopes.
The man who came to Europe knowing almost nothing of the circuits or of Grand Prix racing has won the world championship.
Very soon, I'd be sitting astride Barry's 1977 World Championship RG at Oliver's Mount Race Circuit, but I was feeling underprepared. I needed some more guidance from Steve Parrish, my mentor. So he summoned me to Mallory Park to experience riding on a professional racetrack at speed.
You! You there! Remove your helmet. Steve?
Are you ready for this?
Right.
Because we are going to go out on the track.
Yeah.
And this is very serious because you have to be able to lean the bike, you have to be able to brake properly, you have to be able to use the clutch properly.
Yeah, I think I'd better get out before I get too nervous to actually step onto the track.
The Kawasaki ZX636R is a race-prepared road bike, as close as I was allowed to get to a modern racing machine before I tackled Barry's RG. Steve wanted me to experience the twists and turns of a racetrack with modern technology to help me around.
Deep breath. Good luck. Now you can change up second and third gear.
But this gear change felt alien. So did the speed and the cornering. Even the riding position was a challenge.
Sheen's skill through the bends is exceptional. It looks so easy when you see him doing it, but just try doing it yourself.
I'm just getting cramp in my leg. Hang on. Stretching it out.
A style like his doesn't develop all on its own. And it's his style which takes him to victory after victory.
I'm going to peel off and wave you by, all right?
Yeah.
Open it up.
I was starting to enjoy it. But then this modern machine was a purring pussycat compared with Barry's brutal Grand Prix Suzuki.
Barry probably wouldn't have been as patient as I am. He'd have just said, get out there and twist the throttle and go as hard as you possibly can, and maybe laughed if he'd have fell off.
But fall off, I did not. In fact, I hit 140 on the straights.
It's all come back to me, you know, the speed and the urgency. It's a very urgent sport, isn't it? Motor racing.
And they're off. A fantastic start as they stream out of the stadium up towards
1979, and Sheen was desperate to regain the world championship title he'd lost to Kenny Roberts.
Sheen's past Roberts. A superb bit of riding.
Throughout the season, the two heavyweights slugged it out on the track.
Lap three at Cascades. Roberts is out on his own.
Kenny powered ahead on points. Sheen's last chance to get back in contention rested on the penultimate race of the season. And again, Silverstone would be the stage for an epic showdown. Barry was under immense pressure.
Don't you people have enough to do? You know, we have enough to do on a race day without stupid people. Why the bloody hell didn't they sort it out when they first came through? They never said a word. They stamped it yesterday and the day before. Now on race day, you want to start causing trouble.
All the ingredients were there for the greatest race in the sport's history.
And look at Barry Sheen doing an absolutely monumental wheelie.
The British Grand Prix at Silverstone was one of the most exciting races I have ever seen in my life.
And the crowd rises, the crowd roars, and Barry Sheen leads. The battle is well and truly on, if it wasn't on before.
I don't think you could write the script for that race.
Out on the race.
Lap after lap, the two rode within inches of each other, reaching speeds of 180 miles per hour.
Look at the speed of that Yamaha. Because Roberts goes straight past Virginio Ferrari and takes third position and is now closing right up on Barry Sheen.
I was happy following him, but I would motion up, hey, get going, they're catching us, get going.
And did Roberts hand off the throttle there?
Kenny and I were having such a close race, not more than probably 2 feet apart the whole race at 180 mile an hour. And Kenny was waving his finger at me, joking, and I was waving at him.
And that's when the two fingers came up.
It's quite the end. Look at that. Barry Sheen waves to Kenny Roberts.
He didn't wave. He didn't wave. That's not waving, Barry.
It's the funniest looking wave I've ever seen.
The last but one right-hander on the circuit.
After almost 82 miles of epic riding, they were still neck and neck as they approached the final corner.
But Kenny Roberts goes into Abbey. It's that close, you can hardly divide them on the stopwatch. It's going to be one of the closest Grand Prix finishes for a very, very long time.
I went through that corner flat on the tank in fifth gear. Didn't expect Barry to come around me on the outside.
So now the checkered flag is out. Kenny Roberts and Barry Sheen is gaining. And there is less than a machine's length in it with a fantastic race. And Kenny Roberts won the 1979 Marlborough British Grand Prix at record speed. Barry says, phew, as he shakes his hand.
You know, it wasn't just the fact that I had to race against somebody that was really talented. Winning a race, I don't care who gets second. It was an epic thing because it was Barry Sheen.
As the 80s dawned, Barry was more hungry than ever to reclaim his position as number one rider in the world. He left Suzuki and joined Roberts at arch rivals Yamaha. But he forfeited his position as number one rider, and with it, the control he once had. For 2 years, he was unhappy with the bikes he was given. Then, in July 1982, Barry finally secured one that could match the leading riders, Yamaha's V4.
I got a bike that suits me. At the beginning of last year, I started to ride for Yamaha Factory, and I was riding a bike that was made for Kenny Roberts. Now I'm riding a bike that's made for Barry Sheen, and there's the difference.
And the Grand Prix at Silverstone was where he would stage his comeback.
It was a practice day, wasn't it? It was an unofficial practice day.
Unofficial practice day.
Where were you?
I was on pit wall.
Which was over there?
Over where the old pits were. Just doing a bit of timekeeping. My son Roman was with me and he said, there's smoke. And I said, well, it's just a bonfire or something. And the next thing, Barry hadn't come round. Somebody told me that Kenny Roberts had come in and he was crying his eyes out.
Yeah.
It wasn't very often that Kenny cried for Barry.
So that was the first you knew about.
Yeah, that was the first. And then everybody came running up. I never went out to accident sites, so you never sort of really saw, you know, people falling off their bikes and stuff. So it was the first time I'd seen a scene of a crash. And it just happens to be Barry, you know.
Sheen had collided with a fallen bike that lay on the track. He was thrown 200 yards skidding across the tarmac as his bike burst into flame.
So there was debris all the way. It looked like a bomb had gone off. Barry was sort of lying three quarters
sort of around
of
here
the way
somewhere.
In the track, yeah. Just took one look at him and I thought he was dead. And everybody, I think, thought he was dead, you know, because the way he was lying, it was just, that was it.
At Northampton General Hospital, he was 8 hours in surgery. It needed 26 steel bolts to put his legs back together again. The man who put them in, consultant surgeon Nigel Cobb.
The leg injuries are very severe, probably among the most serious fractures that one can have.
Barry used to talk a lot about what he knew of the accident, and he says he can just remember coming around the bend. He shot forward and he thought to himself, oh my God, I hope my ghoulies were intact. That was all that worried. He wasn't worried about his knees or his head. Important bits of what worried Barry. Unfortunately, we can tell you they were perfectly all right.
Over here, my
dear. We haven't lost your touch, Brian.
Okay.
I hope to get more in a touch than I am.
Barry Sheen was back on the racetrack today, just 8 months after a crash at Silverstone shattered both his legs and threatened to end his career.
For him to get back on a motorcycle again and did what he did was pretty impressive for me. Because he didn't need to do it, but he wanted to do it. And that was Barry Sheen.
Sheen managed 10th place. It was everything he'd been hoping for.
It's sad to have to say it for so great a rider and so great a personality,
But I don't think Barry was ever the same again after that dreadful crash at Silverstone.
I think Barry had had his turn. He was in talks with people, but he couldn't get a good factory bike. And the bikes were going to other riders, you know, who were proving themselves.
In 1985, Barry Sheen retired from professional motorcycle racing. He had brief forays into different motorsports, but nothing could replace his days in the Grand Prix.
I burned my competitive thing out as far as sport was concerned with the bike thing. I could never take anything really seriously after that.
With a climate that he hoped suited his aching, injured bones, Barry emigrated to Australia with his young family and reinvented himself as a commentator. He made a valedictory visit to the UK in September 2002.
Sheen is up there. Sheen is at his shoulder and Sheen drifts it right away out there. And Barry Sheen now leads the race.
Because 6 months later, after a battle with throat and stomach cancer, the motorcycling world lost a legend.
Tributes have been paid to the 1970s sporting icon Barry Sheen, who's died of cancer at the age of 52.
I'm reaching the end of my journey with Barry Sheen. But before I say goodbye, I've come back to where it all started for me. Oliver's Mount in Scarborough, where every year Sheen fans flock in their thousands. It's where I first saw him, and where I'll pay tribute riding his 1977 World Championship winning RG500.
I used to come here as a teenager with my mates, and we used to go around and look, there's the ambulance. He's a bit early. They're looking at me though, with, you know, with hunger in their eyes, because they know they've got a good job there. It's not like flat, like Mallory or Silverstone or anything. It's a proper hilly track. So I think Barry Sheen did about 170 or something down the back there. I mean, which is unbelievable. I wouldn't want to do that, and I'm not. If you take the zero off, you're somewhere near it.
This is the bike that averaged 135 miles per hour at Spa in 1977. A Grand Prix record that has never been beaten. A 180 mile per hour growling beast. An irreplaceable piece of racing history. And if I wasn't nervous enough, Barry's son Freddie had come to see it in action.
I've been living in Australia for the last 25 years, so it's going to be nice to actually see it out on track for once.
You've never seen it in battle?
No, I've never seen it run. So
today, never heard it?
No, I never heard it. So today's the first day for that, and it'll be good. Good to see you out on it.
So here it is.
Yeah.
Does this feel like it's this famous bike?
Yeah, it does and it doesn't. Like, when it's at home, you don't really feel that, but now when it's here and it pulls a crowd just for what it was and him being on it and...
Now it's in its element.
Yeah.
So psychologically, it feels like it's at home.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. all I can say is just take it easy and be kind on it, I guess.
I'll try.
Those hairpins are can catch you out, so take it steady, eh?
I'll go really easy. But fast.
After all my preparation, the moment of truth had arrived.
So down there we have a bike and a rider. Freddy is looking on at his dad's championship winning bike.
The day's racing had been called to a halt, so I could take to the track and Barry's fans had stayed to watch.
Here we go. Helmets on, gloves are on.
I was as ready as I would ever be. I just hoped I could do Barry justice.
All systems go.
For once, his start was perfect. This is where Sheen's skill really starts the show.
So here I was, in Barry's colours, on Barry's bike. And it was biting and clawing to get away.
Sheen's skill through the bends is exceptional.
But incredibly, I realised I was in control, taking corners that made professionals wince. And loving it.
And what we knew had to happen did happen. Barry overtook the Venezuelan to the delight of all his fans.
Barry Sheen is a god to anyone that rides a bike, full stop, because he made it very special. He made it very sexy.
And Barry Sheen is gaining. And there is less than a machine's length in it.
Much, much less exciting place now that he's gone.
That combination of astuteness and speed, hard to beat.
Who's going to be the next Barry Sheen? There will never be another Barry Sheen.
Life's a lot quieter without him, that's for sure.
And now Sheen's doing it. It could well be the Barry Sheen, yes, at the end of the lap, and the crowd rises, the crowd falls.
I did it. Before I did all this, my idea of Barry Sheen, my image, was when I'd seen him, you know, riding around here and on TV, and he kind of looked like a... I always thought he was like a kind of pop star on wheels. And it looks easy, because he makes it look easy, because he's that good. But, you know, I haven't done this, I know that he was ruthless and he had to win. And he went to extremes and there was no holds barred. So, hats off to Barry.